I welcome everyone in today's session, and I welcome Dr. Narendra Jadhav sir in today's special lecture on GDP contraction and remedial measures. Before I hand it over to Dr. Narendra Jadhav sir, I take this opportunity to introduce Dr. Narendra Jadhav sir for all the students who are attending this session for the first time. Dr. Narendra Jadhav sir is a member of Parliament, Rajya Sabha. He is nominated by President of India. Professionally, Dr. Narendra Jadhav sir is an economist, educationist, academic administrator, and he is also author in English, Marathi, and Hindi. As an independent member of Parliament, Dr. Narendra Jadhav sir has carved out a distinct place for himself through his studious interventions in the upper house. He is also member of various standing committees of Parliament, for example, Finance, Commerce, Information Technology, Social Justice and Empowerment, and Welfare of Scheduled Castes and Scheduled Tribes. He is also member of consultative committees on External Affairs, Tourism and Culture. Dr. Narendra Jadhav sir has featured in the Time magazine in October 1997. In the National Geographic Journal on caste system in India in March 2004 and in International Herald Tribune in 2005. Reader's Digest had published a cover story on Dr. Narendra Jadhav sir in October 2006. Sir was a chief economist at RBI, and he had served with RBI. He had worked with RBI for 31 long years. He had also worked with other central banks such as Central Bank of Afghanistan, National Bank of Ethiopia, and had worked for 4 years with the International Monetary Fund as an advisor. He was appointed as Vice Chancellor of Pune University in 2006, and within 3 years, he had transformed the university into a vibrant and dynamic center of excellence, and singularly contributed to making it the most favored destination for foreign students coming to India. Pune is the largest Pune is the city that hosts largest number of foreign students, and Dr. Narendra Jadhav sir had played a key role in that terms. Dr. Narendra Jadhav sir was also a member of Planning Commission, and as a member of Planning Commission, sir has played an important role in formulating the 12th five-year plan, especially in respect of education and skill development. He was also a member of National Advisory Council during the second term of Dr. Manmohan Singh as the Prime Minister. Is a public policy expert and a prolific writer in English, Marathi, and Hindi, and equally a prolific speaker. He had written or edited more than 40 books, and I am saying more than 40 books because every time we introduce him, a couple of books got added to the tally. So it's more than 40 books and more than 300 research papers that... yes, sir.
Just got it.
Yes, okay. Yes, so... on all the literature and research work that he has published, his autobiographical novels, Amcha Bap and Ammi, which is in Marathi but has been now translated in almost all the languages, Indian languages and many foreign languages as well, and Outcast and Untouchables, which are in English, they present deep humanistic values underlying the real life story of struggle for human dignity by a scheduled caste family. And we are really fortunate that a very distinguished professor who is not only associated with MIT World Peace University and MIT School of Government, but along with that, with Ashoka University, with Indian School of Business, with Masters Union Business School, is with us today to speak on the Indian economy and the particularly on the GDP contraction and what could be done to revive the entire economic scenario. Sir, now I hand it over to you and request all the students to switch off their audio system to keep themselves on mute. But all of you can switch on the video if your bandwidth permit. And in between, if you have any questions, you can type it in the chat box. And in the end, we will certainly have the question answer session. But if you could type it in the chat box, that is also quite good. So over to you, sir, now.
Thank you. A very generous introduction, and I'm very happy to know you have used my some old used and there is always a change. But this was one of the few times when my latest CV was used for introduction. Even when I was speaking to you, I delivered Professor Haridas, this is the first book on national education policy. 41st book, and that has just been released. I will be releasing that in a little while. Online release, of course. So this is my 41st book, I think. So I'm very happy to be here today. I have already spoken to you about the national education policy in one of my earlier interactions with you. But it always gives me a great pleasure to come to MIT and give a talk, whether in person or in a series like Eminent Guest Lecture Series, such as this one. And today I have a really hot topic to discuss with you. GDP contraction and remedies for survival. GDP contraction and remedies for survival. Before I go into the subject, let me also thank Professor Haridas for organizing this talk, and along with Professor Parimal. So coming back to the subject, I think this is a very important subject and a very hot topic, and I want to really begin at the beginning. I'm going to assume that all of you, while you may be well read in terms of newspaper, etc., in terms of the full clarity of economics, I think I will have to begin at the beginning. So let us start with what is GDP? The subject is GDP contraction, remedies for survival. So let's begin by understanding what is this GDP. GDP means gross domestic product. What is GDP? GDP is a sum total of all the value added in the economy. So everybody adds value to the economy. So if you add up all the net value added by different individuals, companies, business premises and businesses and so on, and government, of course, and exports and imports, net exports. So sum total of all this which adds value is GDP. Sum total is measured from the demand side, or it could be measured from the supply side. And I'll come to that. For example, from the demand side, if you see GDP, you can write down one equation, very simple equation. Y, which is GDP, is C plus I plus G plus X minus M. I'll repeat. Please write it down and keep it in front of you. Y is equal to C plus I plus G plus X minus M. Y here on the left hand side of the equation is GDP. C is consumption. Consumption meaning private consumption. I is investment, which is private investment. Yeah, Professor Haridas has written it down. That's very good. So C is consumption. I is investment. When I talk about investment, this is not investment in stock market. This is macroeconomic investment, which is spending money on creating capital, like buying a taxi. Taxi is a capital good. So tractor is a good. So this is the investment that we're talking about. creating produced means of production. So that is the private expenditure on that is called investment. This has not to be confused with investment in share market or investment in any financial instrument. Then the third one component is G. G is the government spending. Government spends on all kinds of welfare schemes and paid salaries to everybody. G is the government expenditure from the demand side plus X minus M. That X stands for exports, M stands for imports. So X minus M stands for net exports. If your country's exports are more than its imports, net exports would be positive. If imports are more than exports, then net exports, that is X minus M, would be negative. So that is what from the demand side is. Y is equal to C plus I plus G plus X minus M. Now this is from the demand side. When we talk demand here, we don't talk about in the sense of wanting. We talk in terms of people actually spending money on that. You may want anything, you may demand anything, but unless it is backed by purchasing power, it has no meaning, isn't it? So we are talking about effective demand, that is consumption, private consumption, private investment, government consumption and government investment, plus net exports X minus M. This is from the demand side. Now, if you want to look at anything from the supply side, how will you find the Y, that is GDP? Very simple. You know, the economy is seen as composed of three sectors, mainly agriculture, industry, and services sector, right? And what you can do is look at all the value added in agriculture. Add to that all the value added in manufacturing or industry sector. To that, you add all the value added in services, and it will work out almost as C plus I plus G plus X minus M, which is equal to Y, which is GDP. So GDP is the sum total of value addition made in the economy during a particular year or particular period of time. Now, GDP, I'm tempted to tell you an incident about Dr. Kalam. While talking about GDP, I cannot talk without mentioning Dr. Abdul Kalam. You know, before Dr. Abdul Kalam became president of our country, at one point of time, he was on the board of directors of the Reserve Bank of India, and I was the secretary of directors, and Bimal Jalan was the governor at one point. And Dr. Abdul Kalam, true to his great spirit, he would ask questions, very innocent kind of questions he would ask in the board meeting. Those were questions were actually not very worthwhile asking in the boardroom of RBI, but he used to. He was always a student. So one day he asked, "What is the GDP business?" I say, he said, "Sometimes it goes up, sometimes it goes down. So when does it go up and when does it come down?" Now this is truly a beginner question, not to be raised in RBI board. But Jalan, and everybody used to respect him and take him in a proper spirit. Dr. Jalan had a very funny comment to make. He said, "Dr. Kalam, it's very simple. How do we, when does it go up, when does the GDP go up, and when does it go down?" He said that, suppose that you employ a maid servant in your house and start paying her the salary, the GDP country will go up. Yes, I understand that, Professor Dr. Abdul Kalam said. Then Dr. said, then later you get married to that lady and stop paying the salary. The GDP of the government will go down. our great scientist was very confused. He said, I will confine myself to rocket science. This is beyond my understanding and recognition. Anyway, so that is GDP. Also note, when while talking about GDP, you must always note that GDP can be measured at current or it can be made at constant prices. I'll tell you why. You know, any value is a product of volume multiplied by the price, right? Value is equal to volume multiplied by price. So when we are talking about value going up or down, value can go up if the volume is increasing, or it could also happen if the price is increasing, right? The measuring rod itself is increasing. So when your GDP as aggregate value is going up, you must know whether it is because more volume of goods and services are produced, or it is it because prices are being higher. Usually, it is a combination of both. That is why you will always find that GDP numbers are given not only in terms of current prices, but more relevant. In fact, the most relevant is they call it real GDP. When they talk about real GDP, they're talking about GDP at some constant prices. So some year is chosen as a base price, and GDP is calculated, that is, values are, value additions are made, added together, and they are valued at the same yardstick as before, at a fixed period of time. That gives you a picture of the increase in the volume if you keep it at constant prices. And that is why that concept is called real GDP. So whenever people talk about GDP going up or down, they must be talking about real GDP only, because nominal GDP can go up if there is more inflation in the country. That is not something worthwhile. The real volume is not going up. Goods and services produced is not rising, but only the prices have been increasing. That's not a very healthy situation at all. So we always talk about real GDP, the GDP which is computed at current prices is also called nominal GDP. So there is a distinction between nominal GDP and the real GDP. I hope everybody is clear that about the difference between nominal GDP and real GDP. Whenever GDP number is given to you, you must always first see whether it is the real GDP or nominal GDP. And you must focus on real GDP. Now, what has happened is that all the newspapers are talking about it, and the hot thing that is there around is that there is, and I quote, 23.9% decline in GDP. Here we are talking about nothing but real GDP, remember. Where we will be talking about nominal GDP. So the headline is that there is a massive reduction, massive decline in GDP of 23.9% year on year in the first quarter of the financial year 2021. I'll repeat the headline. And let's first understand what does it mean before we go into the causes and the remedy. The headline is 23.9% decline in GDP year on year in quarter one of financial year 2021. Now, what is the financial year? Just for everybody to be on the same page. Financial year starts with 1st April and ends with 31st of March. So when we talk about first quarter of the financial year, we are talking about the second quarter of the calendar year. As we all know, calendar year begins 1st January and ends 1st of December. So the calendar quarter one is 1st January to 31st March, whereas for financial year, which runs through April 1st to December to 31st of March next year, the quarter one is always April 1 to June 30th of that year. Is that clear? So either we can talk in terms of first quarter of financial year. So what has happened, this 23.9% decline that has taken place, that we are told, is in the first quarter of the financial year 2021. That means there is this decline of 23.9% of GDP in quarter one of financial year 2021, which means during the period April 1st, 2020 to June 30, 2020. Okay, so April 1st to June 30th of 2020, current year, that is the quarter that we are talking about. There was also a word that I used, year on year quarterly decline. You know, 23.9% decline in GDP year on year in quarter one. What is this year on year business? It means it's slightly tricky to understand. You take GDP during the whole year, beginning July 1st, 2019. To June 30th, 2020. I'll repeat, from GDP during the period July 1st, 2019 to June 30th, 2020. And from that, you subtract the GDP during the year April 1st, 2019 to March 31st, 2020. And that will give you year on year quarter one decline that everybody is talking about. So that I hope clarifies what are we talking about. And 23.9% GDP year on year in quarter one of financial year 2021. 2021, that means 2020-21. Okay, all right. Now, how severe? Everybody is saying that this is a massive contraction. Yes, it is massive contraction, 23.9%. How severe is this contraction? How does it stand as compared to our own performance earlier? And how does it compare with what is happening to earlier to other countries? How good or bad it is as compared to expectation? There are a number of points that I want to make here. First of all, if you don't mind, I'll sip some tea while I'm talking. First of all, please note that this 23.9% decline is so sharp that one quarter before that, what was the growth? It was plus 3.1%. During the same period last year, what was the growth? Plus 5.2%. So if you compare with the previous quarter, it has come down from 3.1%, plus 3.1%, to it has come to minus 23.9%. That is a swing of about 27%. If you compare April to July of 2020 with April to July of April to June of 2019, you will find that during this period, when this year the GDP has, in this quarter, the GDP has come down by 23.9%, for the corresponding year period last year, it had actually increased by 5.2%. So there, the swing is more than 29%. Second point that I want to make, this is the biggest quarterly decline that has taken place since we have started computing quarterly GDPs. It was not from 1947 that we had the series of quarterly GDP. Quarterly GDP estimation started in 1996, and I contributed to the methodology at one point of time. So this started in 1996. So from 1996 until this day, there has been never before such a big fall in the quarterly rate of growth of GDP. What was the expectation? We know it's 23.9. 23.9 is an underestimate to some extent. You know why? Because if you look at MSMEs, their data is not adequately captured in GDP. And they are the ones who are hurt the most. And therefore, if you make allowance for all that, the actual decline could be even more. So it is a very, very serious affair. Why is this serious affair? We'll come to that. But what was the expectation? The expectation GDP is going to fall. You know why? Because of Corona. Everybody knew that. It was bound to fall because it's happening everywhere. So, but in our country, the expectation was that GDP would come down in this quarter by 18%. So it has far exceeded our worst apprehension. We were most interlocutors or commentators had said estimated it to be down by 18%, but it actually went down by 23.9%. How does it compare with other countries in the world? Look at the topmost countries, which are actually quarterly comparisons are very important. But still, just for your reference, let me say that amongst the G20 countries, G20 are the group of 20 countries, which includes all the countries that matter. India is one of them. China is there. India, China, Brazil, Russia, and these countries, in addition to the other big countries, the USA, Canada, Australia, Japan, and so on. So all the countries which are systemically very important, they are all there, 20, group of 20. They are the most powerful group in the world. Among the G20 countries, India's performance has been the worst, in the sense that the decline of GDP has been most severe in all these countries. Now, most severe as compared to all other countries in the group of 20 and also outside the G20 countries. The only country among the G20 which has shown a positive growth is China. But China had a huge crash in the previous quarter, what we call April to July quarter is what we are talking about. But if you there, China has come out, is the only country among G20 which has come out with a positive growth rate. But this is on the back of a huge crash that was there in the previous quarter. So first calendar quarter of China, they had a huge crash and they have recovered or on the way to recovery, one can say. But about Chinese data, you never know whether to what extent you should believe. Now, having said that this is the most severe contraction in G20 countries, two examples I want to give. The countries which are supposedly most affected by COVID, and that is United States and Italy. In United States, in this quarter, comparable quarter, GDP has fallen by 9.5%. In Italy, the same quarter, the decline is 12.4%, which means that as compared to other countries, the fall, the decline in GDP in the first quarter of this financial year is certainly more severe than others. But please note that almost in all discussions, when they talk about decline, they rarely, if ever, mention what is the picture. First thing that you have to understand, that there is a decline everywhere. And it varies in degrees. In some countries, it is more. In some countries, it is less. But decline is there everywhere. So it is not that all of a sudden, India is the only country where the GDP is suddenly dropped by 23.9%. No, no. All the countries have had. But we all know that the common factor is the corona crisis. We'll talk about that. Now, let's move on to, just to understand this a little bit more, how does the picture look? By the way, when we talk about so much of decline, remember that unemployment has shot up during this big fall in GDP. And there are numbers are in India, unemployment numbers are not very reliable, but going by the numbers given by CMIE, that is the Council for Monitoring Indian Economy, CMIE, that shows that 2 crore or more jobs have been lost. The actual lost job, forget about creating more jobs. The salaried jobs were lost to a large extent, and the numbers may differ, estimates may differ from one another, but it's very clear that there has been a huge blow. Therefore, this decline of 23.9% is very severe, and there is no doubt about that. How does the picture look for the whole year as of now? We do not know how long it will take for lockdown to be completely lifted. We don't know. But overall picture for the Indian economy, a consensus picture. As I said, in the first quarter of this financial year, GDP declined by 23.9%. Second quarter of this financial year, that is July to September of this year, it is expected to come down by, it will be coming down by 10.4%. So from 23.9% minus, it will be minus 10.4. In the third quarter, it will be minus 5.4. And in the fourth quarter, it will be minus 4.3. Which means that the decline, this is a terrible quarter. This is a terrible quarter, 23.9%. But this is not going to remain like that for all the remaining quarters. There are signs, and current estimates are from 23.9 negative growth rate, it will go to 10.4, minus 10.4 in the next quarter. Third quarter, it would be minus 5.4, and fourth quarter, it will be minus 4.3. And for year as a whole, the decline would be, consensus forecast is about 10.8%. But those numbers can differ. I can show you a picture of how different estimates are there. If you see, this picture shows how much different people are estimating the overall fall of GDP in the whole year. This is Crisil is saying that GDP for this year, here as a whole, April to March next year, it will fall by 9%. ICRA is saying minus by 9.5%. Fitch is saying 10.5%. And Goldman Sachs is the worst one. Goldman Sachs, says, Nomura says minus 10.8%. And SBI says minus 10.9%. And the largest one is predicted by Goldman Sachs, and they are saying 14.8%. The median value is about 12%, which is not so bad as compared to 23.9%. So One first thing that I want to say is that do not get carried away by this number of 23.9%. This number pertains to a particular quarter from April 1st to end of June. And in the following quarters, the extent of decline is going to come down. It would still record negative growth, but for a year as a whole, the growth rate would be close to minus 11 or minus 12%, which is also very, very strong, very severe and unprecedented. From 1947, from 1950-51, when we started the, when the Planning Commission started the compiling, when the data compilation started in India, you know, in a financial year basis and in proper manner, you know, there has never been a fall of 12% annual growth. So it would be historic fall in this particular year. But going by the quarter, you will get an exaggerated notion of the decline of 23.9%. That is misplaced, and that is what I want to emphasize. Why has the economy, why has there been a contraction, and where is the contraction taking place? First of all, while we agree that contraction is there, it is very clear, it's a severe one, but everybody agrees that the most important reason is the most stringent lockdown that we have had. Different countries have followed different strategies for addressing the corona crisis. Many of them had lockdown the way we have, but we have had a very stringent lockdown, and that is the main reason. Most stringent lockdown, some people have called it draconian, some people have called it alarming, but they all agree that this is because of corona crisis. There is one person who disagrees, and we'll come to that in a little while. So it is caused by the longest or the most stringent lockdown that we had during this period, and to some extent it still continues. The partial unwinding is going on. We don't know when things will be completely open. Where has the slowdown occurred? Let's go back to our equation. Y is equal to C plus I plus G plus X minus M. What has happened there is that private consumption has fallen by 15%. Investment has fallen by 15%. Government expenditure has in fact increased by 1.9%. But that has hardly been sufficient to cover the decline of 15% in private consumption and private investment. So, which means that the compensatory package that was brought in at the end of March, 26th of March, that package was not sufficient to, you know, to cover or to take care of the huge decline that was taking place in consumption as well as investment, private consumption and private investment. On the supply side, where have things gone wrong, and to what extent? As I told you, on supply side, you could look at Y as a sum total of what is happening in agriculture, industry, and services. Agriculture, surprisingly, during this quarter, has actually improved its performance to 3.4%, positive 3.4, which is lower than previous quarter, but it is in the positive range. But the industry has fallen by 33.8%, the huge decline. Services have fallen by 24.3%. That is again a huge decline. And the decline of industry and services is obviously bound to happen when things are completely closed. Factories are not producing, and people are not anymore allowed to go to job. Transport is not there. You know, during that period, when the operations are under lockdown, they come to a standstill in most industries. So the aggregate industrial sector output has fallen by as much as 33.8% during this quarter. And services have fallen. Services, particularly if you look at construction services or trade, hotels, restaurants, transport, these segments were completely closed. And in some ways, they are still closed. Transport is still closed. So wherever there is a direct contact with each other, you know, those services were completely under lockdown. Restaurants were completely closed. Now they are opening up gradually. So in the services sector, again, it was hit by 24.3%. So agriculture plus 3.4%, industry minus 33.8%, and services minus 24.3%. That explains what has happened and where it has happened. Now, when it comes to India, while everything is going down everywhere, you know, in all countries, while GDP has taken a beating to varying degrees, in India's case was very special. You have to understand that. Corona, of course, hit everybody. It has hit us. But there are four factors that you must understand why the impact has been so severe in India. First, Indian economy was already slowing down before the corona crisis hit. In the year 2016-17, our growth rate was positive 8.3%. In 2019-20, that is end of March 2020, our growth rate had come down to 4.2%. So, but it was in the positive territory. And then came this quarter, and this whole year is going to have negative quarterly growth. And therefore, that you have to understand that economy was already slowing down. Second is that our health infrastructure has been rather weak. We have been spending, in spite of all the tall talk by our leaders of all political parties, when it comes to education and health, we have not been spending enough. And we have been spending on education, health, only 1% of our GDP. It has gone up now. But what does it mean? It means that so far over the years, our health infrastructure has not been strong. And therefore, the impact is bound to be stronger now on the economy. Third thing, financial sector in our country, even before the COVID crisis hit us, was not very robust. There was a large increase in NPAs and so on. And the fourth factor that we must take cognizance of is that India has a very large unorganized sector with migrant labor estimated to be about 8 crore. And regrettably, as we know by our experience, you know, when the package was announced, we all forgot about them, the migrant workers, which are to the tune of 8 crore people. And you will recall, you know, hordes of migrant people, labor, moving from place to place, trying to walk their home from Kerala to Bihar, or from Haryana to or Delhi to Bihar or Uttar Pradesh. It was a very, very sorry sight, you will all recall. So these factors have to be taken into account before we fully understand. Now, everywhere, the policymakers' dilemma was this, that whether to save lives or whether to save livelihoods. Please understand this. This was the policymaker's major challenge. Whether to save lives or whether to save livelihoods. Suppose that the objective is to save lives, then you will keep your economy under lockdown. But when you keep your economy under lockdown, there can be a major, massive unemployment, poverty, malnutrition, and all that can happen if you keep the economy under lockdown in order to save lives. Suppose that you say that we have to take care of the livelihoods, rozgar, we have to retain them, in fact, improve them. On the other hand, if the policymakers had kept the economy running, you know, airlines should be running, restaurants should be running, transport should be running. If all that was done, no lockdown at all, then what would have happened? More and more people would have been sick and very large number of people would have died. So when we try to, this is the policymakers' dilemma. When they try to save lives, they lose their livelihoods. When they try to save livelihoods, there's a chance of losing lives. This is the dilemma. So difference of, there can be any number of differences of opinion with the government. However, please note that you cannot, you have to strike a balance between, which is not easy. How long now, for example, if they keep the lockdown for a longer period, the economy will go down further. But if they cannot indefinitely go on keeping under lockdown in order to save people, because the economy will die, you know, it will crash. But time, if they suddenly open everything enormously, and that would create its own big problem, and there would be large number of deaths. So that is the challenge that they have. Now, what did we do? We, in our country, lockdown was announced on the night of midnight, of late night of March 24th this year, March 24th. And within 48 hours, the first package came out. And then there were a series of packages, six packages came from March 26th to May 17, and the government touted, saying that, look, we have given, come out with a package of 21 lakh crore. 1 lakh crore is 12 zeros on one. So you can imagine what a large number that is. 21 lakh crore rupees, or 21 trillion Indian rupees. This was a large package, and we had discussed this package at length. But for those who were not present at the time, let me say that although this package was very large, 21 lakh crore, this was 10.6% of our GDP. Our GDP is about 200 lakh crore. So this package was about 10.6%, 10.5% of our GDP. USA came out with a package of 10% of GDP. Most countries had a package around the same level, 6%, 7%, 8%, 10%, 11%, 12%. Malaysia was the highest at that time. Malaysia came out with a package of 16% of GDP. Now, this was not bad at all. This looks very good that India came up with a huge package of $21 trillion. 21 trillion Indian rupees, or 21 lakh crore. But the devil is in details. As I explained at the time, and I will say that again, out of this 21 lakh crore, 13 lakh crore came from government, and remaining 8 lakh crore came from the Reserve Bank of India. What Reserve Bank of India gave was in terms of making liquidity available, making credit line available. That was not giving purchasing power in the hands of people. Okay, it was giving them concessions. Even government, if you look at the government's 13 lakh crore, these 13 lakh crore were not additional purchasing power in the hands of people. I wish it was, but it wasn't. The additional purchasing power, see, many provisions were there in the budget, and this package was very good, no doubt about it. But let's understand the limitations. The limitations of the, you know, good things people have talked about, but let's understand the limitations, because we're talking about the next step now for the recovery. out of the 13 lakh crore, the extra budgetary additional expenditure was only 1,56,000 crore. Nobody can say this is very, very impressive or very, very large. So what happened was, while there were many provisions, now, for example, take the case of tax concession. They said that TDS reduced by from 10% to 7.5%. It was not cancelled. Remember that tax deleted source would be, instead of 10%, it would be 7.5%. But at the end of the year, you have to give the whole tax. There is no concession given there. So there is no additionality of, it's only that for more time you have liquidity available, then giving collateralized loans, giving bank guarantee, giving all kinds of insurance. These are all very, very important things. They are necessary, but they are not sufficient. So in terms of the purchasing power given in the hands of people, beyond what was given in the budget of this year was only 1,56,000 crore, which is only 12% of the whole package. And therefore, it was not very essential, not very impressive. It was essential, but not very impressive. And in fact, at that time also, while speaking in this forum and other forums, I had said this is a survival package, and this is necessary, but this is not sufficient. And in course of time, they will have to come up with more packages that will give stimulus to the Indian economy. I said that in April. Those videos are available on YouTube. You can go to my own channel, exclusive channel on YouTube, and find they're all there. I had said that this is necessary, but this is not sufficient. And in course of time, they will have to. No, I had said, yes, I remember now. I had said that no matter what the finance minister is saying, this is not the end of it. This is just the beginning. And in course of time, bigger packages giving stimulus to the economy would be called for. And that is exactly where we are now. And we'll come to that. While talking about the recovery, there is a famous theory which I have been used long time back, 2005, 2008. But now it has become very common. You know, there can be four kinds of recovery from when you are down, when the economy is down. There can be four kinds of recovery. U-shaped recovery, V-shaped recovery, or a W-shaped recovery, or L-shaped recovery. These are the four main types. Let us understand this. The worst is L-shaped recovery. In L-shaped recovery, there is a big fall and no recovery at all. You know, L, just imagine word letter L. So there is a big fall, and then economy stays at that level. So that is no recovery at all. That's the worst possible scenario. The best possible scenario is U-shaped recovery. That means economy goes down, but quickly takes a U-turn and comes back to where it was. That is a U-shaped recovery. That is not happening. And we know after 6 months lockdown, it can't happen at all. Immediately, it can't happen. So U-shaped recovery is the best possible one. But that is in the given situation. In the given situation, that doesn't look feasible at all. So what we are hoping for is V-shaped recovery. That is our dream. V-shaped recovery, there's a sharp fall and then there is a sharp rise, like China achieved. In the previous quarter, China had a big fall. And then in the current quarter, when the world is going down, China has a sharp recovery, at least going by their official numbers. So everybody's dream is should have V-shaped recovery. And that is what everybody is hoping for, aiming at. Then there is the remaining one is W-shaped recovery. What is a W-shaped recovery? where the economy goes down, it comes up, but again goes down, and then again comes up. So there is an instability involved, like like letter W, goes down, comes up, goes down, and comes up again. That is W-shaped recovery. Now, what are different people saying about this going into the future? Let's start with a person who disagrees with all this and says that we are heading for an L-shaped recovery. And that is our own colleague, Rajiv Gowda, who is no longer a member of parliament, but he is associated with World Peace University, MIT World Peace University. And he is now chairman of All India Congress Research Department. Now, this is why I did not join a political party, because you lose credibility of what you are saying. As a professional, look at what he has been saying. He has, in an article that he wrote last week, September 8th, Rajiv Gowda has been saying, and I'm quoting him, central government response to this crisis is unconscionable. I'm quoting him. It has sought to hide behind calling the crisis an act of God and terming the contraction as exogenous shock. I'll repeat, I cannot believe a person can make a statement like that. Now, I'm not worried about what the finance minister said about the act of God. I'm not talking about that. He is saying that contraction of our GDP is not an exogenous shock. It is not externally imposed thing at all. I think probably anywhere in the world, I do not know any other person who is saying that this downward decline or shock is not exogenous, that this is brought on by COVID crisis is a kind of crisis which happens once in 100 years, and it has affected every country in the world to a differing extent. So to say that our decline is exogenous, that is not. To say that government is hiding behind this being exogenous is absolutely wrong. It's a political propaganda. And I wish he had not said that, because it is impossible to defend. How can you say that? You know, he goes on to add that, after saying the government has sought to hide behind calling the crisis an act of God and terming the contraction as exogenous shock, it is not. It is the result of grave economic management. So he's saying that this big decline is not because of COVID-19. No. This is not COVID-19. This is not something which is externally imposed on us. This is a result of the economic mismanagement of our country. I think this is a very irresponsible. And what is my friend Gowda's, Rajiv Gowda's logic? He said, Indian economy was a vibrant one earlier. Then came the twin shocks of demonetization and hasty GST. Government did not restore the health of banks' balance sheet. Earlier government also did not, but he's right to some extent. India had ample time to prepare itself for the virus and for ensuring, for the ensuing economic challenge. Where was the time? It hit us, and hit us very hard, like it hit everybody. Modi government did neither. It gave only slogans, a 20 trillion package and Atmanirbharta. That's all that they gave. And this unplanned lockdown pushed this slowdown into a GDP contraction of quarter one of this massive extent. And he calls it J-curve effect. You know what is J-curve effect? According to him, now he has added this to the lexicon of economics. J-curve effect. J-curve, he says, is the Joomla effect. That by giving a package of 21 lakh crore, they are hoping government, and these are his words, government is hoping that once the virus problem is over, then the animal spirits of people and businesses, they will come up and they will take the economy up. So there would be a mild slowdown and then there would be a sharp increase. And he calls that a jumla. You know, I think this is very, very wrong and unfair. And I completely disagree with this kind of thing. But then he goes on adding, what is the solution to the problem? There he is quite sensible. He said that the L-shaped recovery could still be averted. Very good. It could still be averted. So how? Now, look at this. You know, people do not talk about specifics at all. It could be averted if the vicious cycle which leads to depression is replaced by virtuous cycle. So what is the big deal about saying this? This is very obvious. Vicious cycle is one where you do one thing wrong, things go bad, then you do another thing which is even worse, things become even worse, and then, you know, it takes the economy down in a spiral. That is the vicious cycle. And then on the other end, there is a virtuous cycle. What does virtuous cycle mean? You do something good, it has a multiplier effect, so it brings about something even better, and then that leads to something even better. So there is a virtuous cycle. So he said that we need to convert the vicious cycle into virtuous cycle. Nobody can disagree. But how it is to be done? He comes close to saying something specific. He says we need deficit financed and well-aimed initiative that generate multiplier efforts and initiate a virtuous cycle of growth. So what he is saying that government should go on printing money. Deficit financing is that. That we government should go on printing money and government should be involved in a big way and give a push to the economy, and then the economy will come up. But anybody who knows ABC of economics knows that there are limits to deficit financing. And if we go for too much of deficit financing, it will create a huge inflation, because if the deficits are exceptionally large, it would create too much money, and the too much money chasing too few goods will lead to a situation which is highly inflationary. And inflation, in fact, is the most iniquitous form of taxation because it hurts poor the most. So, but he is saying that it is required by deficit financing. That is the outcome of what he is saying. Let's talk about what Raghuram Rajan is saying. He is far more sensible, although the spirit is same. He is far more sensible than Rajiv Gowda. He is Raghuram Rajan, the popular former governor of Reserve Bank of India, my colleague. GDP contraction is alarming, he says. And what is he saying? Bureaucracy should come out of complacency and take meaningful action. This is playing with the words, coming out of complacency. But he has made a very important point. After an initial burst of activity, it seems that government has retreated into a shell. So after that big package, there has been no package at all, which is correct. And this is what I had said in April 10. And so he is saying that there should be an economic stimulus package. So what is needed is, he is not saying deficit financing or what, but that is where everybody is going. There has to be an economic stimulation package. And why is it necessary? Now here he gives a brilliant example. He says that, think of all the patients. When the disease is vanquished, I'm quoting him, when the disease is vanquished, the patient needs tonic to get out of the sick bed faster. Otherwise, what will happen is that if you do not give the tonic in the right time, then the patient can go into atrophy, which is organ damage because of degeneration of cells. So don't wait for too long. Don't expect economy to come back on its own. You require a tonic, a economic stimulus package. He does not define how that package works, but he makes his point very, very clearly that you cannot wait for too long for a package, a new package, and that you have after the 26th March package, you have not come up with any package. It is about time that you come out with a big package. And he has made that point very well. He's saying that COVID-19 is raging, still raging in India, and discretionary spending, especially high contact services such as restaurants, are going to stay low until the virus is contained. So the much, he believes that the much awaited V-shaped recovery is not happening. There is a pickup in the sectors like auto sector, but that is reflection of pent-up demand, according to Mr. Raghuram Rajan. Now, this was said on 7th of September. Fortunately for us, now we have a data on 11th September, that is just a few days back, latest data became available. And this data goes beyond June, and this is the data about July. And what does it show? India's industrial production contracted, came down by 10.4%, which was better than the previous month, which had witnessed contraction of 16.6%. So in June, month of June, the contraction was 16.6%, and in July, it came down to 10.4%. Contraction still. We are still in the negative range, but much less than what it was earlier. So this means that the green shoots are already there, and we need to nurture them. All this discussion goes to show that there is a big push of reforms which is needed, going beyond the March 26 to May 17, those six packages that were brought out. Now we can talk about all the six pack as one package. So that was basically a survival package that has worked reasonably well, and time has come now for a bigger package, which will be in the nature of giving a big boost to the economy. And that is what is needed. And what is really needed is not only a big size like 21 lakh crore, of which purchasing power is very little, guarantees and relaxations are only temporary. No, I'm talking about giving purchasing power in the hands of people, in the hands of businesses. Now that is what we are talking about, and we need to put the money in the hands of people and businesses, and this must be done without any further delay. That is the moral of the story, that is where we stand. As we go on unfolding, as things unfold about the lockdown, reversal of the lockdown, the economy will pick up. But then this is the time to come out with a big package. And I do understand that a big package is under consideration, but I cannot talk about that. I do not have final information about that. But the point well said by Raghuram Rajan, and to some extent even by Rajiv Gowda, that moral of the story is that there is a need for a package. Whether it is exogenous, nobody wants to go into that road. But where we stand now, the economy needs a package, and that is the message. And without this package, which will work as an economic stimulus package, as a tonic for Indian economy to get up and start moving faster and come out of that negative range sooner rather than later. And that is the aim of objective of getting the V-shaped recovery. That is what we should aim at. That is where we stand as of now. I'm going to stop here now and take your questions. if any. Please. Let
Yes,
me take
thank
a deep
you.
breath first.
Yes, please, sir. Thank you so much for this sweeping review of Indian economy and the causes of the present state of the economy, and also the broad remedial measures that could be there for the economic recovery at this point of time. And you also compared it well with the other world economies. I mean, we cannot see the Indian economy in isolation, and we have to also see that almost all the world economies, they are experiencing more or less similar type of crisis. So this is linked to the global economy as well. So that also you have brought out in a very clear manner. So we will take questions now. So those who wish to ask questions, please unmute yourself and ask the question. Please be brief.
I want all the questions to be asked in one go, and I'll write
okay.
it down. Try to answer at one go.
Yeah, please. Yes, those who wish to ask question. Yes, Swastika. Pranay Kumar, if you could ask the question. Yeah, Akash, go ahead.
Sir, my question to Mr. Narendra Yadav is, sir, you told us that Mr. George Fernandez to expel Coca-Cola from India. So could we have a brief discussion of what kind of that?
Well, actually, today we had a discussion on the Janata Party government and Mr. Fernandez's decision to expel Coca-Cola. So he's asking it in that context.
Okay, all right.
Yes.
Yeah. More questions. I'll answer all questions go. So more questions.
Yes. Sir, Pranay Kumar is asking, is the another stimulus package expected just before Bihar election?
Yeah.
Yes. Zakaria.
Yeah. I can't hear you.
Yes. Please go ahead. Yes, Kostub sir, please go ahead.
Hello, sir. First of all, thank you for such an illuminating session. I have a couple of questions.
Yeah,
number one, I would like you to briefly discuss about the pros and cons of Atmanirbhar Bharat call against this COVID situation. And second one, you mentioned about the proposal of Dr. Raghuram Rajan, but on the other hand, he also cautioned us regarding the printing the money or borrowing from Reserve Bank of India along with the former Deputy Governor Viral Acharya. So I would also like you to guide us upon the same issue. On one hand, government is falling short of revenue, and we are also, the way of printing money is also not very much available. Thank you.
Sir, I have a question which is not actually on the economy, but on the COVID-19. And we are seeing that while other countries, they are having, including India, they are having increasing cases of COVID, from a considerable period of time, China is showing no growth in COVID cases. So as per your information or the insights that you will be having with regard to the happenings in China, how is it possible that the virus that originated in China, that spread first in China, and now their cases are constant on 80,000 or 83,000 for last few many weeks, while our cases are increasing. So how is it possible?
Okay, all right, wonderful. So shall I start answering?
Yes,
again?
Yes, sir. Yes, please.
Okay, I got five questions from four people. First one was about Coca-Cola being expelled out by George Fernandez at that time. I would link it with what is being talked about in terms of Atmanirbharta. That is what I would imagine is the connection. And Kaustubh also asked a question about Atmanirbharta in the present context. Personally, I think that that was a great decision at that time, but no decision is great all the times. If Coca-Cola was not expelled, many of our domestic industries would not have come. Look at it this way. If IBM was not expelled at that time, that was another big kill. If that had not happened, TCS, the Tata Consultancy Services, would not have come up in the big way that they have. So many decisions at that time turned out to be very relevant, but something which is relevant at a point of time is never true for all the times to come. Please understand that in the mid-70s, when these two decisions were taken, there was a big debate going on in the world, particularly in the Asian part of the world, to go for export promotion or to go for import substitution. So there were many countries advocated export promotion. India opted for import substitution. In my opinion, that was a huge mistake at that particular point of time. At that time, because the countries which opted for fear free trade at that time, they have all done very, very well. And their trade to GDP ratio is more than 100%. You know, you take case of most Asian countries, they were called Asian tigers. But in 1996, those tigers were also in trouble, but for different reasons. We opted for import substitution. This was actually convenient to a lot of people, because by import substitution, you protect your country from foreign competition. So the domestic producers do not have to face any competition from abroad, so they can maintain their inefficiency without being worried. The best example I can give is the Fiat and Ambassador car. Why is it that 50 years Fiat never changed its engine? Why is it that Ambassador never changed its model for 50, 60 years? Because no other cars were allowed. So, in fact, to buy Fiat and Ambassador, there was a huge queue and people were bribing. So, inefficiency breeds these kind of things, and that is what was happening. In the long run, it hurts you because of our wrong choice at that time, policy choice of opting for import substitution. We did not grow well at all, and we treated export as a surplus, you know, last resort, not priority resort. Later on, gradually it became an important thing when we were hit with the biggest economic crisis in 1991, where our foreign exchange reserve had come down to only $1 billion. Today we have $450 billion. Now that's a huge stash of money that we have with the Reserve Bank. At that time, we had $1 billion, which means that we had no money to pay to our importers, to people, that those who were buying from abroad. And 76% of our oil is imported. So if you have no money, dollar to pay, they are not going to accept money in rupees. So when that happens, you will not be able to import oil. If you don't import oil, all the industry would have gone completely down. So that was the big crisis that it led to. So the moral of the story there is that you export promotion, import substitute. This debate is now long gone. Now everybody in the world believes in export promotion. until recently that was, but now there is again the nationalistic feeling coming in America and in other countries. So people are looking at different options. That's where we are. Another question was, is there some other package that is coming? Is it coming for Bihar election? I do not know whether they are waiting for Bihar election, but as you are undoubtedly aware, it was not possible even to hold parliament session, and with great debate, finally, because constitutionally we cannot hold parliament, the gap between two sessions cannot be more than 6 months by constitution. And there are 11 ordinances, some of them are very important ordinances, 5 of them are about COVID-19. Those ordinances would be abrogated if they are not approved by the parliament. The life of an ordinance is 6 months. Therefore, the gap cannot be more than 6 months. So with great difficulty, they have finally found a way to restart the parliament, and it is going to open on 14th. So I do not think that the package has anything to do with Bihar election, but the package will come. I believe that they do understand the enormity of the situation, and package should be coming sooner rather than later. Kaustubh asked questions about Atmanirbharta, plus and minus about it. Atmanirbharta in today's context that you are asking, I think Atmanirbharta is a very clever word used by Honorable Prime Minister. That does not mean like the old times we are going to be, you know, isolating ourselves from the rest of the world. You know, only two countries did not go for globalization. One was Myanmar and the other one was North Korea. And nobody can say that they are the countries which are well placed or to be emulated. And even they are now trading more than before. So there is no country which remains in isolation. So Atmanirbharta does not depend on that. What I think what we are trying to do is that to develop our own network of supply chains. Now, today, and this partly covers your question, you know, Parimalji, that China... there is a lot of criticism in the world about China. And let me explain this. Let me explain why Chinese numbers are not showing up. No numbers in China are reliable at all. And as you are aware, you know, there is this feeling, they are not even willing to accept that it started in Wuhan. They hate American president for calling it Chinese virus. You know, but, you know, I think everybody knows that people have come to realize what China is and what they are saying and what they are doing. Incidentally, in the WHO, the World Health Organization, the chief of which was particularly chosen by the Chinese, he's from Ethiopia, from Eritrea. He is the one against whom there are complaints made by USA and many other countries that for a long time under Chinese instructions, the information about this virus was kept under wraps, and the severity of that was not disclosed. And when there was a very strong remark made by the WHO chief by Americans and others in their board meeting, apparently at that time Australia supported the US, and in response China called Australia a pet dog of United States, which is very, very surprising. The arrogance that they are exhibiting now is truly astounding, I think. And why are the cases are not coming out? I mean, why are the, because China is not a democracy. There is, you know, they decide which news has to go out and which news doesn't have to. And, you know, so nobody in the world believes that at the worst possible time that there was so few cases in China when it started. Nobody believes that number. The actual number could be much higher. That's what the international media has been saying and talking about. So that said, Atmanirbharta means a lot of industries, are a lot of investments in China are coming out and they're going elsewhere. And India is a natural contender for that. Natural contender. We should have taken a bigger advantage of that, but earlier we didn't, but now we are doing that. Now we have a pact with Australia as well as Japan, where, you know, we are trying to develop alternate supply chains. Underlying logic is China is unreliable. We don't know. World has suffered and credibility gap is there. And therefore, we should have different supply chains. Atmanirbharta actually means, you know, change supply chains in favor of our country and, you know, reaching out with our own supply chains, reaching out the rest of the world, substituting the Chinese supply chains which are prevalent today. That is how I take it to mean. I do not think it means staying away from the rest of the world, that you do what you like and we are going to stay in our own shell. That kind of Atmanirbharta is not to be expected at all. One final question about borrowing from RBI. Yes, Raghuram Rajan has said that, but there is a little bit of double standards. I must admit that, Kausub, because do you know that earlier, RBI generates profits every year, and RBI has accumulated a lot of reserves, because what they do is that earlier system was, when the profits are generated, a part of the profit goes to the government, because government of India owns RBI. So it's their money, so to say. So part of the profit goes to the owner and remaining one is added to the reserves of the Reserve Bank. Non-foreign exchange reserves, these are Indian currency reserves we are talking about. And those are for contingency and for a variety of purposes. Now, over a period of time, we built a lot of reserves. About the last time I saw it was 9 lakh crore rupees reserves. And there was a big demand that these reserves, why should RBI need all these reserves? You know, they can be used for developmental purpose, they could be given to the government. So government appointed a committee under the chairmanship of Dr. Jalan, and that committee is still, I don't know, their first report came out later on, I don't know what happened, but the part, they have given a program to give money in batches to the owner. Now, this is when Raghuram Rajan was not there. Earlier, he has strongly opposed this, which is fine. However, you know, during Raghuram Rajan's time, a decision was taken and he meekly signed that entire profit earned by Reserve Bank of India in a year for 5-year period would be transferred to the government of India. So what I am saying is that there are double standards involved here. Now, opinions could differ, but I think personally, now I have a strong allegiance with the Reserve Bank of India. Personally, I think that yes, there is a room for a part of those reserves to be shifted to the government, but the opinions can be different. RBI maintains AAA rating because of the way it has conducted itself, the way its reserves are. A part of that, particularly when there is a national calamity, they should be used. And as you have seen, the package did contain 21 lakh crore package, did contain 8 lakh crores liquidity. liquidity, not natural cash, but liquidity coming from the Reserve Bank of India. So they are playing their role in this process. And it would be very logical to get more resources from the reserves of the Reserve Bank of India for the betterment of our nation in this hour of crisis. I think it's 5 o'clock and we will stop here. I'm running out of my breath, and I think
yes,
questions are all answered. So I thank you, Parimalji, for having organized this. And I may have left some questions unattended. I think I covered all of them.
Yes.
But this is only a beginning in the sense that might make you think about it in a more logical and more insightful manner. If I have done that today, I think the purpose has been achieved, for which I thank Professor Parimal. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Sir, to end the program, I invite Professor Kaustubh Sorkar to propose the vote of thanks.
Sure.
Yeah, thank you, Parimal, sir. It is said that the beauty lies in simplicity, and I must say that over and again, sir has proved that the simplicity is the attribute of beauty of his speeches. Without any compromise on the content and complexity of the really, really difficult topic, he has beautifully delivered the session on the million-dollar questions of the day, that is the decline in GDP and the remedies to, you know, cure it. So I must say thank you to Dr. Narendra Jadhav, sir, from the bottom of my heart on behalf of MIT WPU family. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. And we would like to hear you over and over again and again. Thank you. Thanks a lot. Over to you, Parimal, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. And thank you to all the students, all participants. And with this, we end today's session.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.